Now we turn to Mr. Gaurav Gogoi. We're glad to have you here. You were here 2 years back when President Obama came in the same hall, and I remember that audience liked your comments. So let me ask some different kind of questions. Though there are admittedly visible differences in the style, articulation, execution of foreign policy under Prime Minister Modi, neutral observers feel that there is considerable similarity and continuity in the broader objective which the UPA and NDA government have been pursuing in relations with the US since 1991. Ever since the successive government, India and US have contributed towards the unprecedented transformation in our bilateral relationship which we witnessed today. Do you think US-India relations will continue to expand under President Donald Trump, as has been said by some of the panelists earlier? Both the UPA and NDA government had flagged the increasing assertiveness of China, especially with regard to territorial claims in South China Sea. Do you think the Trump administration will engage closely with countries like India in press for freedom of navigation and overflight throughout the region, especially South China Sea, as envisaged in the US-India joint strategic vision for Asia-Pacific Indian Ocean, which was agreed during President Obama's visit to India in January 2015. Both India and US have been victims of international terrorism. There has been reference that we have been sharing a lot of information and we can work. But there are some people who strongly feel that this war against terrorism cannot be fought unless the US takes some punitive action against Pakistan for being the epicenter of terror. Do you think President Donald Trump will take any initiative in this direction? Mr. Gaurav Gogoi.
Ambassador, thank you very much. It gives me great privilege and honor to be part of this distinguished panel and to be present at this IFA seminar once again, but discussing a very different president. First of all, I do want to say that let us not underestimate President Trump. Any politician who has entered the world of politics with relatively limited political experience has completely outsmarted traditional pollsters and traditional political pundits in the US, have defied what the polls predicted, has managed to win votes from the Democrat Party, is definitely a smart and out-of-the-box politician and certainly someone who has a disruptive influence, and disruption is his style towards politics, and that's what we should understand and try to engage with. We can also see that, you know, that in his first 100 days, he is going on consolidating his vote base. All of his steps, whether all of his statements, whether on the travel ban, on the wall, on Mexico, on industry, they are all reinforcing the messages that he sent out to his core constituency. So in a way, he is in a perennial election campaign mode. He is still trying to win the support of his base and trying to make himself look good. The way, although on a slightly different vein, the way he is criticizing the media, the politicians, the political processes, I mean, certainly he knew what he was getting into, but I think he's taking a leaf out of the hat of Delhi chief minister, who thinks that just by criticizing others, you are gaining sympathetic votes. But as the ratings show, that this does not win any sympathy, it does not cut any ice. And I'm sure that this is a strategy that President Trump will leave quite soon. Now, when it comes to, there was quite a common perception that irrespective of whether the US president is President Hillary or President Trump, not much will change between in the factors, in the variables of the India-US relationship. Now, clearly that has, I think, we've deviated from that. There have been very important questions that have been raised. I think it's too presumptuous of me to give a conclusion, but extremely important questions have been raised. The first is the strategic importance of India towards the US. China and balancing China was very critical in terms of India's importance in the US policy towards Asia. After the 2008 Asia pivot, we see that while the economic and commercial trade and investment relationships between India and the US had not improved significantly, but the strategic ties had multiplied and really evolved exponentially. Given the fact that this president is more inward-looking, is more focused on trade and economic balances or imbalances with China, does that mean that there would be less focus on the South China Sea? With his approach towards Philippines, with his flip-flop statements on Taiwan, have important questions been raised about either the continuation or the dilution of U.S. interest in South China Sea, which I feel will have a direct impact on our India's strategic importance or attractiveness towards the U.S. Secondly, a major deviation from President Obama was President Obama's focus on the Middle East, especially on Iran. He really wanted to redesign the relationship between the U.S. and Iran and focusing on the nuclear peace deal, which would have only benefited India. If there had been positive relationships between U.S. and Iran, if there's peace and stability in the Middle East, the U.S. continues to engage both with Israel and with Iran and maintain peace and stability, that would have been in India's own interest, given the presence of both of our diaspora in the Middle East, as well as that we also have stronger commercial relationships with Iran as well when it comes to natural resources. So if President Trump deviates from President Obama, takes a harder stance on Iran, and India also under Prime Minister Modi follows that trend, focuses too much on Israel and does not balance enough with Iran, I think again we'll have to ask questions of whether what is in our long-term interest. I know Ambassador Hardeep mentioned about strategic autonomy, but I don't think this government was practicing strategic autonomy. Strategic autonomy was a concept that was being practiced in the previous government, but in this government, the government had too closely aligned itself with the US. It talked about freedom of navigation, talked about the South China Sea, and now is following on the line of the US President Trump on the Middle East as well. I think what this government needs to do is actually follow strategic autonomy, understand that while with China we can have a competitive relationship, we can also have a collaborative relationship. Understand that in the Middle East, we need to engage with Israel, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and the other countries as well. Now, coming to other deviations that I see, because again I sense that I don't want to jump to conclusions, but I sense deviations. President Trump's comments on renewable energy has a bearing on our India's own renewable energy policy, because we depend a lot on investment from the US. As part of the Paris Climate Change Treaty deal, getting foreign aid for technology innovation is a huge part of our renewable energy targets, which are completely ambitious. Now, if there are questions are raised about US's own commitment towards renewable energy, towards Paris, that will also likely to have a bearing on our investment that we're likely to seek. Secondly, on the economy, we have seen that President Trump is very inward-looking and is looking at the interest of American employees and American companies. So as a parliamentarian, to hear what the CII representative has said, that there are a lot of legal cases against Indian companies, there are a lot of commercial restrictions on Indian companies, whether it's in pharma, whether it's in food, whether it's in agriculture, has an impact on us as parliamentarians as well, because the states that we come from, agriculture is a strong part of our state's economy. So if our exports are hit by US restrictions or US protectionism policy, that has an impact on our local economy as well. And we hope that globally established rules and norms are followed when it comes to legal disputes, settling legal disputes. And we hope that President Trump does not bias or is not allowed to bias American companies' interest over Indian companies. When it comes to the chemistry between President Obama and President and Prime Minister Modi vis-a-vis President Trump and Prime Minister Modi, I think if in President Obama's tenure, if similar questions were raised about H-1B visas, if in President Obama's tenure, similar questions were raised about the safety of Indian workers there, about the, you know, this the sense of security that Indian IT professional workers are feeling currently in this environment, then I think President Obama would have addressed these issues, would have made a statement to these issues, would have tried to apprehend. Maybe the legal document or the legal language, as Ambassador Shankar is saying, does not lead to any cause for concern. But a politician also has to address apprehensions and address concerns. And I feel that President Obama would have been that much more forward about allaying any concerns. And I must say that in the recent session of Parliament, many parliamentarians, especially from South India, from Andhra Pradesh, from Telangana, from Kerala, many of them raised very important questions about the safety of Indian IT workers, about the periodic incidents, not only incidents where our Indian IT workers have been attacked, but also incidents where they have been verbally and racially abused. Each and every incident is important and cannot be treated lightly, because there is an environment which is being propagated through media and politics, which is creating only enmity within our society. Coming towards the end, and I think a very crucial part of your question, which is his approach on terrorism. Again, there are two points to this. A, I think President Trump is very serious about terrorism. He talked about terrorism. The travel ban is related to terrorism. But I think his approach to terrorism, given his approach to any all the other issues, would be very inward-looking. It would be about domestic tourism. You might see more snooping laws and cybersecurity breach, more invasion of privacy that had happened under President Obama. That might even continue, given the backing that President Trump might give to the CIA or the FBI or to the NSA. And lastly, on Pakistan, it all depends on President Trump's defense and military advisors. So whoever gets more closer to President Trump's ear will have a bearing, because Pakistan's leverage in US is with the defense department. It's with the DOD. It's not with the state, it's with the defense. So if the approach of DOD or the weight of DOD continues in this administration, I don't see much changing. But I was also worried about this statement that they might, under President Trump, look at a very disruptive approach, look at a multilateral, multi-party negotiation to the Kashmir dispute, which would completely upend what Indian negotiators or Indian foreign diplomats are always saying, that Kashmir is a bilateral issue. President Trump just might be have a disruptive influence and might make it a multilateral or global issue. So with that, I'll end my closing remarks, and thank you for giving me the extended time.